Ladies and gentlemen, from the flight deck, this is your captain.
Hello everyone, Nick from Quality Wings, and today I'm going to talk to you about taxiing the 787 Dreamliner. I'll give you a little minor tutorial here on the airport moving map display on the ND, and then I'll taxi the airplane in both a heavyweight and a lightweight configuration so you can kind of see some of the differences between those two weights and the characteristics that they encompass. So I've got us loaded up here at our favorite Payne Field, Seattle, Everett, and I'm in the Dash 9 Rolls-Royce powered airplane today. Engine type doesn't really matter. I chose the Dash 9 today because it's a longer airplane than the Dash 8. It's not as long as the Dash 10, but having the longer airplane will help me demonstrate kind of some of the things that you need to look out for when taxiing the airplane. Before we get rolling here, I'll just show you that we've got the airplane weighing about 542,000 pounds, a little bit off of the max takeoff weight of 560 or so. Just want to simulate that heavy weight, and I'll move the yoke out of the way. I didn't put a flight plan in or anything like that. We're just going to taxi around. We're not actually going to go flying. But I did want to show you a couple of nice features that Ernie added to the airport map here that'll help you taxi the airplane with a little bit more ease and awareness. And he's put some, as we call them, Easter eggs, or little hidden features that you can enter into the scratch pad to depict things on the ND. So if I wanted to depict gate 16 here, I would enter G, fat fingers, period, 16, in the scratch pad, you see that flashes. Pretty cool. So you can enter the gate that you're going to after you land, you want to park at, it'll highlight that on the map. Same works for taxiways. Let's depict taxiway Alpha out here. T is in Tango, period, A. And you see taxiway Alpha illuminates in amber. Super cool. And finally, we can depict the runway with R, period. And let's do 16 right. And there's runway 16 right in red. So, a couple of things that you can type in here, G for gate, T for taxiway, R for runway, to help you get around. When you're taxiing, it's important that you always have the moving map displayed, and that can be accessed by just scrolling the range knob down here. As I zoom out, eventually it'll disappear, and I don't have a route in it, which is why it's just hooking off to the south. But for our purposes, we'll zoom back down to the lowest range and start the taxi demonstration. So, a couple of things before we start moving here on heavyweight taxi. Sometimes the airplane will have enough residual thrust from the fans and the engines to start rolling on its own. All you have to do is turn off the parking brake, the airplane will start to creep forward. At light weights, it's not a problem, as you'll see in a minute. Heavier weights, you might need to give it a little help. A lot of it depends on the surface. If it's concrete, nice and smooth, possible that the airplane's gonna start rolling on its own. Asphalt, blacktop, things in the hot sun where the airplane kind of sinks down in, and some airports like Philadelphia, San Francisco, that have a lot of heavies, you can actually see grooves or trenches in the taxiway. And to get over those bumps, you need a lot of power. So my technique is to release the brake and wait to see before doing anything if the airplane rolls on its own. And what I do is I look down here in the corner, somewhere along the glare shield here. I also look at my ND here to see any sort of movement. And we're not rolling today, which means I'm going to need to add a little power to help it. So when it comes down to breakaway thrust, less is more. In the sense that, once again, these big fan engines out on the wings can move a lot of air. If you have men, equipment, catering trucks, baggage carts, trees, anything behind that's susceptible to wind damage, if you run these engines up to 45-50%, it's a lot of power, a lot of wind, you could do some damage. So what I'll do is just slowly bring them up to maybe 20, 25%. And then look back here, and you can see it didn't take much. We're already rolling. Here's one knot. And once we get up two, three, four knots, can bring the power back to idle, and it should keep rolling on its own. And I make this right turn, 90 degree turn here. And you'll notice I do what I call the overshoot technique, which is I'm actually going to turn and put the taxiway center line kind of behind my right shoulder. And I'm doing that because if I zoom outside, you'll see how far back the main gear are from the nose gear. And I don't want to put this inside truck too close to the grass or the edge of the taxiway. I want to keep the center line in the middle. So you could do that by overshooting the taxi line. If we were making this left turn here and I turned too sharp, you'd see that that left main would cut possibly inside this line. And here I'm sure, because this is big apron, this is all stressed for the airplanes to taxi on. But if this was grass, or if it was just the side of a taxiway and it was not stressed and you went into it, you could break it up and get stuck in the grass or stuck in broken pavement. So you want to do the overshoot technique to prevent that. Okay, we're up to 6 knots here. And I can go back to idle power. And I just kind of watch this ground speed. You'll see we're just sort of rumble along. If it drops down to 5 knots or so, we just add a little power. When we're heavy like this too, we make these turns to the left, just add a little bit of power to keep the momentum going to kind of help it out in the turn. All right, for this turn, I'll turn inside and demonstrate the non-overshoot technique. So I'm just kind of exaggerating and turning early. But if I go back outside again, watch how close this truck gets to the edge of the taxiway. This is a pretty wide apron, but you can see before when I overshoot, did the overshoot, the wheels were up here. Now they're pretty close to the edge, which is why you wanted to kind of do the overshoot in the first place. Keep yourself on the center line. So that's pretty much it for heavyweight taxi. I'll go ahead and stop here and set the brake. A couple of things I'll point out. Anytime you're making a 90 degree or more than a 90 degree turn, speed is everything. So too much speed, if you're going say 10, well, I'd say more like 15, 16, 17 knots, and you go to make a hard turn to the right or the left. Remember, these airplanes have a lot of inertia, a lot of mass. We can't really feel the mass. About the only thing we can't really simulate is the feeling of the mass of these airplanes, like you do when you fly on them in real life. I mean, we can make the cockpit shake and we can rattle and we can do that sort of thing, but we can't make the feel of braking or inertia or acceleration unless we get a full motion simulator that can do all that stuff. So if you're going too fast and you try to make a 90 degree turn, you have the potential of, getting, I'll just roll here to can demonstrate while I'm talking. This one I'll just bring up to about 30%. We'll get rolling nice and good here. And then once we get going, roll the power back to idle. Anyway, if we're cruising along at say 15 knots and I make a hard turn to the left, I got a really good chance of scruffing or skidding that nose tire, leaving a big black streak of rubber along the pavement here. So we need to be going less than about 12 knots or so is the rule of thumb, 10 knots to make a 90 degree turn. Conversely, you can also be going too slow, particularly in heavy weights. 2 knots, 1 knot. If you go to make a hard turn to the left or the right, the airplane may stall out or stop. And if it were to stop halfway through a 90 degree turn, I'd have to add, let me see if I can demonstrate that here. So I'll go ahead and I'm trying to make this 90 degree turn here to the left. I'm doing my overshoot. See where the main gear is. Just slow down here. So I'm trying to make the turn and I stop. All right. Now, if I really need to get moving and I want to keep that turn going, I got to bring up the power a lot. And I have the potential of blowing somebody over. See, I'm still at one knot, but I got 40% power. Doing some damage behind me. So you don't really want to stall out in the turn. What you're looking for ideally is 3 knots, 4 knots when you make that 90 degree turn. Otherwise, see how much power I got to add just to keep this thing in the turn? Now, once I straighten out, now that will start to increase. So that's pretty much it for the heavyweight taxi. Now I will lighten the fuel load to, let's see here, put 15,000 pounds on to simulate. We've just come in from a crossing. We're lightweight. 350,000 pounds, so now almost 200,000 pounds less than where we were when we started the taxi. Totally behavior, the behavior on this one is completely different. As soon as I take the brake off, this thing's gonna roll. Brake's off, look out here at my little light. See, I'm already rolling, already indicating speed on the nav display. And if I let it, this thing will go up to 35, 40 knots. A lot of people question, hey, is that realistic? This doesn't seem right. One of our beta testers is a trip by, excuse me, he's a 7-8 captain for a real world major airline. He's flown the 747, he's flown all kinds of things. And he told me, I worked a lot with him, that he has never ridden the brakes so much in any airplane that he's ever flown. Part of that's because they're electric brakes, but this thing really, you know, he took off the other day from Munich, went all the way out to the runway at idle power, and it got up to 30 knots without him touching the thrust. So as you can see, we're already up to 21, 22 knots, and it just increases. And I'll let it get up to 25 or so knots, and then I'll just do a gentle brake back down to 10, and then release. What I'm doing is modulating the brakes, not riding the brakes. These are carbon fiber brakes, which work fantastic, but if you keep riding them and don't release, keep braking constantly, they'll heat up, and that's very hard on the brakes. Eventually, they don't last as long. So the technique is to go up to 25 knots, back down to 10. Up to 25 knots, back down to 10. So on and so forth. And you notice I haven't touched the power once. It just rolls on its own. And it has the tendency, it will go all the way up to 35 knots. That's accurate. Many, many airplanes in the real world do that. You just bring it back, and particularly when you're coming into the gate area, you have the potential to. You're going kind of too fast, and so you want, once you're coming into the gate area, back down 10 or so knots. Back down to 10. And I think this is my turn here. I'll make one more kind of overshoot turn just to demonstrate once more the technique. I'm sure you guys are familiar with it now, but it never hurts. So you can see this one is more than 90 degrees. It's kind of like a reverse high speed. So this one, I'm going to bring the speed back down slow, down to around 5 knots. And I'm always thinking in my mind, where are the main landing gear? I can't really see them back there. So if I turn now, I'm going to take the main right through that area. So I'm going to push this lead-in line behind my shoulder. And then I kind of can look here at my speed. I want to be around, there's 4 knots. So I'm overshooting. See where the mains are? And still gonna overshoot this line as well. Put that line behind my shoulder. Now I'm gonna cut it hard. I'm at 4 knots. I've got enough, there's 5 knots, enough energy to carry me through the turn. I go back outside. You can see that the mains are nice and squared away on the center line. I made that big sharp turn. I'll go out onto the runway here and make this left turn to line up. Same principle here. Back up to 10, 12 knots. Slow down to about 5, and this time I'm going to put the center line past my left shoulder. Let's see, 2, 4 knots, 3 knots. Okay, so it's right about here. I'll start slowly turning. Now I'll cut it hard, and I just kind of feather the inside break. You don't really want to lock the break because that twisting motion on the truck is very strenuous. But you can see where it is, and we roll right out on the center line, ready to go. Set the brakes. So that's it. That's a demonstration on how to taxi the Dreamliner in both the heavyweight and the lightweight configurations. And as always, hope you enjoy it, and we've got more videos to come.